Chataka-san, for your introduction. It's always a delight to come to Jeff's meeting with such a succinct efficiency and then kind hospitality. And thank you, PIDS, also for hosting this year's event. Jeff has come up with very good guiding questions for us to do the presentation, and I'll focus on these few questions. That is, how do countries usually experience regarding their technology and innovation policy, and whether innovation technology drive the inclusive growth or having sort of phase out some of the opportunity for some people, and what are some of the policies that foster social inclusion and political participation? How do we manage negative impact of technology and innovation, and how do we maximize the potential for all this? So I will share with you some of my observations. If I mention some of the countries, not the others, it's only because for the ease of understanding and my familiarity with some of the cases. This is a global digital index that's done in January 2017, which tells us about the digital economy's emergent impact. With a total population, world population of 54%, that we are under urbanization with modern facilities in the digital economy. And this one highlights about 50% of the whole population use internet. And the whole world, 37%, have an active utilization of social media. And then 66% owns handphone, mobile phone. Whereas 34% get into these social chat rooms of sorts. So the emerging economy, actually, we cannot escape the digital economy or so-called knowledge-based economy. So there's a wide-ranging change regarding the nature and business operation and our employment in various sectors. For example, cross-sectoral issue including manufacturing, the way we manufacture, we no longer need large-scale factory, the 3D printing, 4D printing, etc. You can order one, next day it will come to me across the world, a pair of shoes of my self-designed manufacturing. Industry also, the changing pace of industry, the way they started from R&D design to manufacturing to brand selling, etc. Commerce, healthcare, people don't need to visit the clinic anymore. Their Apple Watch, for example, will tell their doctors what to do. And then people started to wonder, are doctors and nurses going to lose their jobs? And then also we started to work at home as instead of traveling, you know, getting stuck in traffic jams, home as a workstation. And then the organizational chart has been flattened out instead of very hierarchical order. Education and then the changing fast pace of technology require us to have a lifelong learning, because when we publish a book, in 2-3 years time, it's going to be all outdated. Teleworking, etc. So impacts are enormous in terms of job relocation, and then the work vis-a-vis leisure hours, social isolation. Sometimes you are so much into chat rooms that we forget to meet our own people, our family members, relatives. How do we manage our times and the organizational structure? How about managing the teamworks and social networking? Etc. Are we satisfied with our job? How about economic growth index vis-a-vis the happiness index, for example? However, Chinese have an old saying that when we finger point others, the four fingers actually pointing at us. So we should not blame technology technology or innovation, but see how we should readjust it to it. So issues facing innovation, I will highlight a few countries' experience that, in my observation, from education to nurturing HIV, all right? In Taiwan's government during the 60s, we sent out our graduate students to go to study electronic engineering, to mechanic engineering, another two, material engineer, computer science, across the board. Government orchestrated this high-level education by sending out to learn the most advanced one. So if your education system cannot turn overnight, then in the case of Singapore, for example, biotech hub, they started to recruit a lot of foreign talents, HIV. From ground zero to reverse engineering, in the case of Japan's automobile industry, in the very beginning, it starts from zero. But now they do reverse engineering and better their technology accordingly with their return students from higher education. From uniformity of culture to nurturing a sense of diverse, encourage difference, encourage thinking differently, act differently, and then design differently. From government-induced incubation to public-private partnership. For example, in our Hsinchu Industrial Park, we invited back the foreign talents, including Taiwanese, and then set up a hub, a good environment for them to continue innovation. And then also public-private partnership. Government cannot do everything, so they have to include private sector. From copycats to IPR protection, from standardization to harmonization, sort of having the industry standard, contingency problem solving to total solution. Why would we think about unemployment? The best case would be Nordic countries. They have weathered the sunset industry and then asked the people to reduce their salary of 80%, 70%, 50%, etc., gradually, and ask them to retrain in the so-called sunrise industry. National competition vis-a-vis global connectivity and social discontent and structural reform. I've been indicated only 3 minutes left, so I'll be quick. So basically, most of us are going to be knowledge technologists as a dominant social forces. And how do government adjust to this? I think we have to help SMEs, for example, to run their business utilizing the existable software, whether it's food catering, whether it's clothing, whether you are selling rental unit, whether you are doing transportation like Uber, whether you are doing entertainment. Get them used to the tool. The innovation and technology have nothing to be dread of, but whether the government orchestrate in such a way to help facilitate the usage. So, this one I have already. APEC growth strategy. People say APEC is a perfect excuse for chats. But whether we try to really digest this and have a concrete measurement, what does inclusive growth mean? How do we measure it? How about innovative growth, secure growth, sustainable growth, balanced growth? Do we have a manual version? Do we have the so-called best practice? How do we articulate in such a way that it's not only our domestic problem, but we learn from each other? Lastly, I'm just going to quickly pinpoint, and if I go over 1 or 2 minutes, forgive me. Now, how do we maximize the potentials for innovation? I call it technology and innovation, it's 真善美. You don't have to dread about it. We can make it faithful, wonderful, and beautiful. How do we do that? I suggest the following. Policy for inclusive growth, basically, it's about social re-engineering, education, lifelong. labor and management, how do we balance it out for political participation? About sustainable growth, basically there are three particular forces: push, pull, and have a visible hand in market irregularity. Push is to phase out, for example, the pollution industry. Pull, encouraging green technology. Visible hand, getting the incentive and disincentive policy ready. And then in the region, although we think APEC goes sour, however, the spirit about liberalization, facilitation, and economic cooperation remain useful in terms of helping out each other in the technological innovation. Thank you very much.